Happy birthday to
you. Oh, I should have been recording.
The officer started singing to her. Everyone else joined in. Laughter followed, and the situation ended peacefully. And those are the headlines from The Source, WOCA 96.3 FM and 1370 AM.
Broadcasting from the Paddock Mall Studios, this is WOCA, Ocala, Gainesville, The Villages, 1370 AM, 96.3 FM, The Source.
All right, 7 minutes after 10 o'clock. Thank you for tuning in. Nice looking Thursday morning. Jeremy Daubert is on the phone. He wrote the book, Jewish Comedy. If you're looking at the podcast, you're seeing the cover of the book. It is number one in its category on Amazon. I just looked at that. Jeremy is an Atron professor of Yiddish language. How many Yiddish words do you know, Roman?
I don't know. I think I know one from you, Oy.
So you don't have to be Jewish to learn Yiddish. You just have to hang out with a bunch of Jewish kids. That was my childhood. I learned a few Italian words, too, when I was a kid. Jeremy is also, a finalist for the National Jewish Book Award. He wrote the libretto for an opera that played in Boston and a movie that screened at the Cannes Market. He wrote a column for the Christian Science Monitor on TV and movies. And again, his book is called Jewish Comedy, A Serious History. Oh, I'm such a fan of comedy in general, and so many of my favorite comedians just happen to be Jewish. I don't know if there's a reason for that, but it just so happens to be. Good morning, Jeremy. How you doing?
Good. Good morning, guys. Thank you so much for having me.
You're welcome. Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from New York City, where I'm a professor at Columbia University, and so calling from my office.
Oh, nice. Did you ever toy with the idea of doing stand-up or doing some kind of comedy?
You know, I never did, although it turns out that, being a professor, you end up getting up in front of audiences, a couple of times a week.
Right.
And try to, not always try and make them laugh, but you're trying to do something. So it helped me figure out a little bit of what these guys are trying to do, in their routines.
Yeah, I don't know. Was Gene Wilder Jewish? I can't remember if he was Jewish.
Gene Wilder was Jewish, yes. Okay. Yes.
Well, the one thing I wanted to, bring up Gene Wilder, I think he was working with Mel Brooks. And they were having a conversation. I was watching this interview, I guess, right after Gene Wilder died. And he said that he got into comedy because he said something to Mel Brooks, I don't know what it is. I can't say anything without people laughing. And Mel Brooks said, well, you got that face. and that's kind of funny. I mean, do you find that sometimes people enter into comedy kind of not reluctantly, but just almost involuntarily?
You know, I'm not sure whether they enter into comedy involuntarily. I think sometimes people in their own lives sort of non-professionally sort of turn to their sense of humor, involuntarily. They don't have any other choice but to sort of make a joke out of things or to tell jokes to be, to get approval or what have you. Mel Brooks, I think, probably did that as an early age. But I do think that the kind of comedy they tell probably has something to do with, who they are and in some cases sort of what they look like. I mean, I think Woody Allen, sometimes says, for example, that he might have tried other kinds of personas, but with the way he looked, he was never going to be sort of the sports star or the big hero, right? I mean, he was going to be,
and that's funny, isn't it? I mean, just making that comment, it's kind of funny.
Yeah, I mean, he claimed, that he was always athletic and everything like that. But who would have listened to him doing that, right? So he sort of exaggerated these kind of neurotic-y kind of things, which he certainly has. But that way he kind of built into that persona.
Yeah, when the Russian comic that came over, what was his name again? Oh my gosh, you know who I mean?
Oh, Yakov Smirnoff.
Thank you. When he came over, He had sort of license to do Russian jokes that the rest of us might have felt was politically incorrect. Is the same thing in Jewish? I think I heard Larry David, I think, said like a Holocaust joke. And I thought, oh my gosh, nobody else could get away with that.
Wow.
Yeah, and you know, I mean, I think there's been a question because there was a lot of backlash on social media. You're absolutely right that he, a couple of weeks ago, he hosted Saturday Night Live and he opened his monologue, or in his monologue, there was a kind of concentration camp joke. And whether or not he got away with it, I'm not sure. As I said, there's a lot of backlash, but right. there's definitely this question of, you know, who can do what. In fact, there's an episode of Seinfeld, obviously co-created by Larry David, in which Jerry discovers that one of his acquaintances has converted to Judaism for the purpose, he believes, of telling Jewish jokes.
Well, that's kind of funny in itself, isn't it?
Yeah, so it gets to exactly what you're saying is, you know, what kind of role does identity have in kind of authority to be a comedian or a certain kind of comedian, you know, telling these kind of jokes? I think you're right about that.
The one thing about Jewish is that, for example, in the Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis team, way back when, Jewish is a religion, but it's also a culture. So it's got this religious aspect to it that being Italian doesn't have. You know what I mean? I guess in the case of the two of them.
I think that's absolutely right. And, you know, in the book, obviously, I talk both about the way in which Jewish religion and theology and belief have often been grist for comedy for Jews through the centuries, but also in America, what happens when you have an identity where you feel very Jewish, but a lot of the things that made people think, you know, define themselves as Jewish through the centuries, you know, believing in a Jewish religion or something like that, you know, no longer obtain. What does it mean to be a Jewish person and to do Jewish comedy then? And that's something that really people are grappling with now.
And does the comedy work in America, or rather in Israel, as much as it does in America? Is it two different cultures?
I think that's a great question. I mean, I think, you know, so much of what Jewish comedy has been for many centuries has been shaped by Jews being sort of in exile and diaspora, minority people, not in charge, you know. And so what does it mean, what kind of comedy is it when it's a Jewish state, when the Jews have political power? And that's something that, the Israeli comedians are trying to figure out and work through.
I read all of Alan Sherman's books. I mean, one, Help, I'm a Prisoner in a Chinese Bakery, and it never occurred to me while I was reading those books that I should think of somebody as Jewish or non-Jewish. I just laughed my way through it.
Mm.
And I think that that's a very important thing, which is that, you know, one of the reasons to appreciate these comic artists, and I think for anyone to read this book about Jewish comedy, is because they're great comedians, full stop. You know, they take their particularities and they appeal to a kind of universal condition. And that's what the greatest sort of practitioners of Jewish comedy did too. Everyone says, well, I can't, it doesn't matter what.
I think Mel Brooks is first an American comedian before he's a Jewish comedian. Same with Jerry Seinfeld or Carl Reiner, any of them. I think first they're Americans.
I think that's right. You know, and Brooks is a great example of that, because here is someone, you know, who, when he was really riding at his height in the 70s, he says, I am going to take all of these American film genres, you know, the old horror movies or the Western or the Hitchcock movies, you know, and I'm going to make these parodies of them. And that shows sort of this intimate familiarity and this love with American culture. You know, you can't do that if you're not an American sort of through and through, and that's what Brooks was.
Yeah,
And I really enjoyed the men that were telling the jokes and writing and everything, but Joan Rivers, it was really hard for me to warm up to her because she seemed to be on the defensive all the time, even though there were points in her career that I thought she was funny, but I know everybody loved her.
Yeah, I think, you know, Joan Rivers, who I talk about to a good extent in the book, you know, is a great example of this very difficult bind that I think women have been in comedy in general, and Jewish comedy as well, you know, where so much of the comedy is addressed at women through the ages, sort of aimed at them, right? And Joan Rivers, right, as you say, is very constantly on the defensive. She's saying, I'm going to take this, I'm going to take it back on myself. I'm going to make jokes about myself all the time. And, you know, one of the interesting questions is whether or not that becomes sort of a kind of revolution, a kind of saying, I'm in charge, right? I'm the one, you know, who takes this on. And later on, you know, she does this through all of these different ages of her comedies, from being a young woman to sort of being someone who is more of a, you know, was a senior citizen who was talking about plastic surgery and how she wanted to be in charge of her body, you know.
Yeah, and
she's a...
I was going to say...
I was just going to say she's a... Yeah, you go. You go.
I don't mean to step on your words. I apologize for this. There's a little delay, and that I'm going to blame it on that. But I think that's that kind of speaks to the, you know, she's an American, she's a woman, she's Jewish, so all the things that she is. The same thing for Amy Schumer, somebody younger and maybe not so defensive as Joan Rivers was.
Yeah, I mean, I think Schumer is, who I talk about also, a brilliant comedian, and is someone who really, not like Mel Brooks in a certain way, has a masterful sense of American culture. She did this on her show, this very long parody of that old movie, 12 Angry Men, directed by Sidney Lumet.
Mm-hmm.
For example, but she is someone who is saying, still, I want to grapple with what it means to be a woman in the world that I'm in, and the complications and the difficulties of that. And on her show, she has done a remarkable job of doing that, and in this movie, Trainwreck, that she did.
Yeah, tell me the genesis of the book. When did you first think, gosh, I should write a book about the history of Jewish comedy?
Well, it had always been an interest of mine, sort of from my, growing up, but not a professional interest, a kind of interest as a fan of all of this stuff. And then I became, I went to graduate school and I became a professor in Jewish literature. And I said, this stuff has a tradition and you can study it and you can talk about how these things are, all my favorite things are connected to one another. And I started teaching about it. And I said, hey, other people are interested in that too. Everybody brings, their own particular, idol. Comedy idol, whether it was Mel Brooks or Joan Rivers or Amy Schumer or whoever, and wanted to hear more about how these things all came together. And I said, I think there's a book in this.
Very insightful.
Did some of the early on comedians do some kind of self restraint depending on the era? You list the Marx Brothers.
Mm-hmm. I think it's a great question because comedy, is always about sort of pushing limits, which is another way of saying that it's about respecting those limits or acknowledging that they exist, at least. And people who are really sort of the most audacious and bold comics, like the Marx Brothers, know on one hand that they can kind of explode those limits and sort of, go around the vaudeville stage and almost blow it up. But their greatest success is when they work with someone like Irving Thalberg in these movies that they made in the 30s, where they say, we still want this to look like a movie. We want all the craziness, we want all the chaos, but we want a plot too. We want something, that sort of brings it to a conclusion and a close. That's a work of art in that kind of way. And they do that. They're amazing at that, at all those sides of that.
Do you know, Leonard Cohen wasn't a comedian. He was a songwriter, obviously. But there was some similarities, I think, in his approach to his songwriting that remind me of some of the things that you talk about in the book regarding comedy. I don't know that being Jewish is necessarily the reason for that, but it is kind of interesting to notice that similarity in kind of the approach to what you write about, whether it's to make somebody laugh or make somebody think.
I think that's right. I think, one of the things that Leonard Cohen was, as you say, was not a comedian, but what was the greatest at was taking these grand matters of theology, of metaphysics, of spirituality, and putting them into kind of this regular, almost homey, quotidian sort of sense of the rock song, And in some ways, this is what Jewish comedy, one of the things that it does very well is it takes these big questions of, life and faith and God and everything, and it puts them into a joke, a Jewish, and I tell a lot of these kind of jokes in the book of, what it means to try to kind of talk about religion, but in a comic way.
Yeah.
In an everyday kind of comic way.
I think I've even heard Jerry Seinfeld refer to the cast of the TV show Seinfeld as the Beatles. They were like the Beatles in comedy in their era. I mean, they really were. Like John, Paul, George, and Ringo. I can't remember all the... right? Mm-hmm. The four of them.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's right, and you have this incredible collaboration, and you could put it in another way in which Seinfeld and Larry David were like the Lennon-McCartney, of a way that you had this sort of more kind of mainstream populist Jerry Seinfeld and this kind of dark, kind of more misanthropic Larry David, and together they made phenomenal music, improvisation, with the rest of the cast.
Yeah, I agree.
I think you're absolutely, it's a great metaphor.
I'm so looking forward to reading the book. I have the cover of the book on the podcast that we're doing right now. It's called Jewish Comedy, A Serious History, written by our guest, Jeremy Dauber. You're number one, by the way, on Amazon. Let me find that thing again. Number one in Jewish literary criticism. What kind of a category is that?
Yeah.
That category, I don't know, but I'll be delighted if your readers just make it number one full stop. Your listeners, excuse me, make it number one full stop. So, you know, it's a great holiday gift, I think.
I just clicked on it. You're not just number one. You're number one, number two, and number three.
Nice.
Number one is the hardcover. Number two is the Kindle. Number three is the audiobook. Are you the voice on the audiobook?
I am the voice on the audiobook, yes.
Oh, good.
Yeah. So you can, if you want to hear me for a number of hours telling Jewish jokes.
Do you include Jewish jokes in there?
I do, yeah. There are a lot of jokes. And, you know, it's not a joke book, but there are a lot of jokes, and I tell them, and I talk about sort of what they mean and how they illustrate, you know, what the best things are about Jewish comedy through the ages.
And you also, some Jewish comedy, they're also very light, like the television show Friends. I mean, you had that one character, Ross. He was Jewish, and then when he had his son, he was trying to teach his son about Hanukkah, but yet keep Christmas incorporated, and it turned to be a pretty funny episode.
I think you're right. You know, these shows that come out of the 90s and the 2000s, Friends, I think, being one of the most important of them, are these shows about saying, well, Jewish life in America looks very different now than Jewish life in America 50 years ago and for much of its history. It's a life where Jewish identity is part of a lot of different kind of identities for people, where they can celebrate Hanukkah and Christmas, right? And how do we tell Jewish jokes? How do we make Jewish jokes? How do we live a Jewish life in that more complicated situation? And comedy is a way that we kind of work our way through some of those questions. And they did that wonderfully in that Friends episode.
Do you think Yiddish will disappear?
I don't. You know, I once had a conversation with someone who specialized in native languages, and she told me she was working on some native language. And I said, she said, how many speakers are there of Yiddish? And I said, yeah, there are a couple hundred thousand sort of around different places. How many are the language you're working on? And she said, 12.
Oh, my.
Said, well, you are in much more serious. You know, I think there's a very good base. There's a lot of activity in it. There are a lot of people who just speak it as their everyday life. I'm not concerned, thankfully.
When there are scenarios or jokes jabbed at the political realm, do you kind of hide things in there, or are you just straight up where everybody gets it right away?
I'm not sure. Can you just explain to me a little bit what you mean by that? I'm not sure if I follow that.
Oh, okay, because I know, you know, people will make jokes about other people and about politics and parties and who's who in government. Then if you're speaking from a Jewish perspective, do you try to do it in a roundabout way so it's not so in the forefront to make it funnier?
Well, that's a great question. I mean, I think that, you know, the book doesn't, you know, which is looking at some of these kinds of jokes through the ages and up to today, doesn't pull any punches. You know, it's important for everyone to see the kind of full range of things. And I say in the introduction, you know, some of these things are not very nice necessarily, but they're part of the story, and we want to know the whole story. In terms of what I do myself, you know, I try to tell jokes that are not offensive and are not, you know, but at the other hand, they're jokes that hopefully are instructive or meaningful in some way in the classes, you know, that they teach.
Yeah, I would think that most of the comedians that we're talking about are funny to everybody. I don't think it's just to a Jewish audience, but there's a part of this that even a non-Jewish person gets the humor when you're talking from a minority perspective, and Christmas and Hanukkah is definitely one of those topics where, I mean, Adam Sandler does this whole song, everybody knows the Hanukkah song, you know, where he names all the people that are also Jewish and half Jewish.
Yeah.
and it's kind of funny because you realize as a non-Jew the kind of minority feeling, I guess, that you have to deal with.
Yeah, it's a great point. I think, you know, it's a great example, that Hanukkah song, and I bring it up actually in the book as a kind of watershed moment, because, you know, here's this kid. I mean, Adam Sandler's still a pretty young guy when he does this. He comes on Saturday Night Live. He sings this song. He's kind of shocked at the response that he gets. You know, it's like a song about words that rhyme with Hanukkah as much as anything else, right? I mean, you know. But it's a seasonal song, but it's a song about pride, about saying, like, here are all these people you didn't know necessarily were Jewish, but they are, and that means a lot to me.
Yeah.
Meaning Adam Sandler. And it ended up that it actually meant a lot to a lot of other people, too. And as you say, it's a function of being, in this minority, in this sort of culture.
And the role he plays, or Seinfeld, or any of them, the role they play for the rest of us is they feel like friends. And so you feel like, oh my gosh, my friend is in this minority group that I don't normally recognize as a minority group, and they're funny and I love them, and oh my gosh, well, let me go get a menorah and be part of this whole celebration.
I think that's right. You know, before Seinfeld, there were, for a number of decades, there were almost no identified Jewish characters on television. And television, like you're saying, is this sort of intimate, friendly medium, right? Or friends, like you were saying, Robin, right? I mean, they're, you know, and after, that's where, you know, they come into your homes, you know, as opposed to in the movies, right? And then, you know, after Seinfeld, in the 90s, the age of Friends and others, there were lots of characters, right? The sort of the dam had been broken. There were lots of Jewish characters on television, and like you're saying, they were funny and friendly and all of that.
What I get a kick out of is and I hope he starts doing it again, the Comedians in Cars Getting Coffee thing that Seinfeld started, because you see one man with one other person, that'd be Seinfeld with one other guest, and their similarities and their differences both qualify as things to have fun with and to get the rest of us to laugh at.
I think that's right. And, you know, one of the things I love about Comedians in Cars Getting Coffee is that it reminds people, of this lesson that I talk about in the book, that there is a tradition, right? There's a kind of set of relationships. It's not like these individual actors, but all these comedians, they know each other. They know their ancestors comedically. You know, they think about this history. They talk about technique and craft. And, you know, it's something that really they take very seriously. And so, you know, I tried to do that, too. I tried to match that kind of enthusiasm.
And this is such a wonderful journey that you take the reader through with your book. It's absolutely fabulous.
Thank you so much for saying that, Rob. Thank you.
What a fun topic. I've really enjoyed this conversation. Jeremy, thank you for taking some time out of your day to be with us today. Good luck with the book and with everything. I did find it on Amazon. It is number 1, 2, and 3, depending on which kind you're going to buy.
Nice.
It's called it's simple. Simple title, Jewish Comedy, Jeremy Dauber, Dauber. Before we say goodbye, Jeremy, do you have a website?
I do, jeremydauber.com.
Oh, and I've been mispronouncing your name the whole time. Jeremy Dauber, thank you so much for being on the air with us today.
A real pleasure. Thank you both. Thank you.
We'll be right back.
This is JP from Penn Flooring here in Ocala. I would like to invite you to come in and visit our spacious showroom, where we have solutions for every style and budget. From wall-to-wall carpet to hardwood floors and tiles, we have an unsurpassed selection of flooring. At Penn Flooring, we've provided quality customer service with a family touch for over 25 years. Visit our website at pennflooring.com or come by our showroom, 1201 Southwest 17th Street, just over the bridge. Penn Flooring, quality customer service with a family touch.
One of the best things about living in beautiful Central Florida is that we get to have a garden all year long. Spend some time on Tuesday mornings in the garden with Carol Ann Baldwin right here on WOCA The Source from 9 till 10 a.m. Carol Ann will take your phone calls, and she'll even check out your photos on her In the Garden Facebook page. Grab a tall glass of something refreshing and spend an hour in the garden with Carol Ann each Tuesday morning right here on The Source, WOCA.
Broadcasting from the Paddock Mall Studios, this is WOCA, Ocala, Gainesville, The Villages, 1370 AM, 96.3 FM, The Source.